Today in this video of ours, we are going to learn about the process of recombinant DNA technology. In last video, we learned that what are the principles which we are following in this formation construction of recombinant DNA, and then how the vector is used, what is the structure of the vector, how the cloning of vector is done, and what are the different ways by which the competent host is selected and the DNA, the gene of interest, is put into the competent host to get the multiple number of copies. Now today we will learn that what is the process. Processes of recombinant DNA technology. So in this we will go step by step. First of all, we need DNA, because the whole process of biotechnology is done on DNA. So first of all, we have to isolate the genetic material. Now, where is the genetic material? The genetic material is present in the nucleus. So that means from wherever we are getting the DNA, we have to get the purified DNA. And to get the purified DNA, we have to treat the organism, or from wherever we are getting the DNA, with so many chemicals, so many enzymes, so that we can remove the outermost cell wall, if it is bacteria or plant cell or fungus, or we can remove the plasma membrane, then we have to remove the nuclear membrane, then we have to remove the proteins which are present with the DNA, histone proteins are present with the DNA, then we have to remove RNA. So all these things have to be removed before we get the DNA in a purified form. So for that, for the processes of recombinant DNA technology, DNA must be available in its pure form. So first of all, cells are treated with specific chemicals to break open the cell to release cellular components. So we have to break open the cell wall, cell membrane, so that the DNA is available now. So we have to use the enzymes which can digest everything which is present outside the DNA, outside the nucleus. So we have to digest the cell wall, then we have to get that membrane digested, then we have to get the proteins digested, so that we are left with only DNA. So the cellular components such as DNA is present in the cell, RNA is present, proteins are present, and this is done by enzymes. So we have to use different enzymes for different things. Like we are using lysozymes for bacterial cell wall. For bacterial cell wall, we are using lysozyme. So if we are using bacteria, we will use this enzyme. Cellulase enzyme is used. Cellular components such as DNA, such as RNA, protein. DNA toh we want, but we have to remove the other components. We have to get the other components digested by different enzymes. So for the bacterial cell wall, we are using the enzymes lysozymes. And for the plant cell, if we are using plant cell, because the plant cell wall is made up of cellulose, so we have to use the enzyme cellulase. And for the fungal cell, we have to use chitinase. So it depends on what we are using, which organism are we using. So we have to use the different enzymes to get the cell wall digested. So these are the enzymes which are used. Then contaminants. Why they are called contaminants? Because the RNA, the protein which is present with the DNA, is acting as a contaminant. We want DNA in a pure form. So to get the purified form of DNA, we have to remove these contaminants such as RNA and proteins. And these are digested with the help of ribonucleases. Ribonucleases are the enzymes which can digest RNA. And then we are using proteases. Proteases are the enzymes which are digesting proteins. Now, proteins are present. If you remember how DNA is packaged, the proteins are present. Histone and non-histone proteins are present with DNA. So we have to remove those proteins as well. So to remove those proteins, we have to use proteases. Proteases are the enzymes. enzymes which digest proteins. Now, when everything has been removed, we have treated with all these chemicals, after that we are left with DNA. Now, DNA can be separated by adding chilled ethanol. So when we add the chilled ethanol, the DNA will get precipitated. And this is the DNA which we want. So DNA will get precipitated and you will find the thin threads of DNA in your solution, in the chilled ethanol. And this can be seen as collection of fine threads. So this experiment we have to do. This is the experiment which is there in your 12th syllabus. So we will do this. So when we put the ethanol, the DNA threads get separated and you can see the white threads in your solution, in your petrish or wherever you have kept the solution. So you can see that. So this we get the fine collection of fine threads and that is our DNA. Okay, so this first step is over. We have got the DNA in a purified form from the cell. Now the second task is, we have to cut this DNA at the specific location because we are not interested in the whole DNA. We are interested only in the DNA segment where our gene of interest is lying. Whatever is the gene of our interest, we want only that fragment of the DNA. So we have to cut that DNA. Now to cut that DNA, we want restriction enzymes, the molecular scissors. So DNA is cut into fragments with the help of restriction enzymes. Now these restriction enzymes and the DNA, they are put into a medium in a incubation and there they will, the restriction enzymes will cut at the specific point. So we know the recognition sites are there for specific for the restriction enzymes. So we will get the fragment of DNA where the gene of interest is lying. Now these fragments generated after restriction are isolated with the help of gel electrophoresis. So once the action of restriction enzymes is over, we have cut the fragments of DNA. Now we want the DNA fragment different, separated as per their sizes, and that can be done with the help of gel electrophoresis. So gel electrophoresis, we have done a separate video, you can see that if you want. Now after that, once the gel electrophoresis is done, we have got the DNA fragment having the gene of interest or having the recombinant, the DNA which is recombinant. Now this recombinant DNA is obtained by hybridizing gene of interest with vector. Now we have the fragment, the segment of DNA where our gene of interest is lying. Now this has to be incorporated with the vector. Otherwise it's of no use because we want multiple copies of it and only vector can do that. So what we will do is we have to cut the vector as well. So we have to use the restriction enzyme for cutting vector also at a specific point. And there, then this DNA, recombinant DNA will be hybridized. Hybridized means together, they will join together. The gene of interest and the vector, both will be joined together with the help of which enzyme? DNA ligase. DNA ligase will join the sticky ends. And once the DNA ligase will join the sticky ends of both different types of DNA, we will get a hybrid. And this is called recombinant DNA. Now, constructed this recombinant DNA, now we want multiple copies of this recombinant DNA. One or two fragments will of no use. So for that, there is another process which is called polymerase chain reaction, PCR. These days you must be listening to this PCR test for corona. So that is the same thing, polymerase chain reaction. Now, what is polymerase chain reaction? Polymerase chain reaction is the reaction which is continuously being done with the help of the polymerase So we are amplifying the fragment. Like we have got one fragment, we can make it billion copies of that fragment with the help of polymerase chain reaction. That is the advantage of this process. With one fragment or with a small fragment of DNA, we can make billion copies of that DNA with the help of polymerase chain reaction. Now we will see how this polymerase chain reaction is done. So the first recombinant DNA can be amplified by polymerase chain reaction, that is PCR. Several identical copies, same copies will be formed. This is a machine. You know what you have to do? You have to just put the number, copy numbers. You want 40 copies, like you go for Xerox copy. So he will put the copy. He presses the button, no? 10 copies, 2 copies, and the 2 copies will come out. 10 copies will come out. Similarly, in this PCR machine, you have to just press the button. Okay, we want 80 copies. So the 80 copies will come out, identical copies. So this is what PCR is doing. So several identical copies of it can be synthesized in vitro. It is in vitro. In vitro means in under artificial conditions. In laboratory, it is done. Now, another thing which is required here, because you are familiar with the replication of DNA, if you want to revise that portion, you can go back to that video where we have done DNA replication. So when DNA is replicating, DNA requires primers. So here also two sets of primers are required. What are the primers? Primers are the chemically synthesized oligonucleotide stretches that are complementary to a region of DNA. Oligonucleotide is what? We have done polynucleotide. So if polynucleotide means many nucleotides, but if few nucleotides are joined together, that is called oligonucleotide. Clear? So this oligonucleotide is chemically synthesized, and this oligonucleotide is used as a primer. So we want two sets of primer for two fragments of the DNA, because the DNA fragments, it is a double stranded, two fragments are there. So we will first separate them, and for both we want a primer to start the process of polymerization, because it always happens from 5 to 3. So we have to put the primer first, and then we will put the nucleotides in it, and the nucleotides will be taken by the enzyme polymerase and replication can be done. So here we are using two sets of primers, and these primers are what? These primers are chemically synthesized oligonucleotides. These are stretched that are complementary to a region of DNA. They should be complementary. What are primers? Suppose this is the fragment of DNA and it is having A, G, G, C. So what should be the oligonucleotide? The oligonucleotide should be T, C, G, G. It should be complementary to that portion of the DNA. Then only it can work as a primer. So they are complementary to a region of DNA. And which enzyme is used? DNA polymerase. Because for DNA replication, we are using DNA polymerase is used. So we here also, we will use DNA polymerase, and deoxyribonucleotides are also want, because if we don't have nucleotides, then how they will form the multiple copies? So we have to add free deoxyribonucleotides in the solution, so that they can be used for making multiple copies of the DNA. Now there are three steps of this PCR, that is polymerase chain reaction. First is denaturation. Denaturation is what? The double helical DNA structure is denatured. Denatured matlab, it has the two fragments should be separated from each other, and that can be done by providing high temperature. If we give the medium a high temperature, then DNA can be denatured. And this is when denatured means they get separated. Now DNA polymerase will not get degraded, because here we are using DNA polymerase also. But DNA polymerase is enzyme. But that will not get denatured, because here. In PCR, we are using a special kind of polymerase, which is called TEC polymerase. And this TEC polymerase is what? Thermostable. So it will not get denatured in high temperatures. So DNA polymerase does not get degraded in such high temperature, since the DNA polymerase used in this reaction is thermostable. Why? Because it is isolated from which bacteria? Thermophilic bacteria. Thermophilic means the bacteria which can withstand high temperatures. So from that bacteria, the name of the bacteria is Thermus aquaticus. So this Thermus aquaticus bacteria, from this bacteria, the enzyme polymerase is used, is extracted, and that's why it is called TEC polymerase. TEC means T is from Thermus and AQ is from aquaticus. So TEC polymerase. So the polymerase used for PCR process is TEC polymerase. This is a polymerase which do not get degraded in high temperature. This can withstand high temperature. Clear? And then the third stage is, the second stage is extension. First was denaturation, that is the DNA, double helical DNA is separated into different two strands, and then extension. Now replication of DNA occurs in vitro. This all process is happening in vitro, in artificial conditions, in laboratory conditions. So this cycle is repeated several times to generate up to 1 billion identical copies of the DNA. We can get up to 1 billion copies of that DNA. Now see how this process is done. This is PCR. We have taken one DNA. So this DNA, this is the 5 prime to 3 prime, and this is 3 to 5 prime. Okay, anti-parallelity is there. Now what will happen? We will give it a heat, very high temperature. This DS means double-stranded DNA. Now when this double-stranded DNA is put into high temperature conditions, it get denatured. Denatured means the two strands will get separated. So now what happened? These two strands have got separated. Now these two strands, the primers will add into these. So what we have to put? We have to put two primers. Now what are these primers? Primers are oligonucleotides. What are oligonucleotides? They are not poly, means many nucleotides are not there, but few nucleotides joined together, they are called oligonucleotides. So these two oligonucleotides, which are chemically synthesized in laboratory, they are used as primers. So what will happen? They will get attached to the DNA fragment. As per the complementary base pairing, they will get attached to it. Now these primers are to initiate the process of polymerization. Like for painting, we first put primers. So similarly, for DNA replication also, primer is required. So primer will start the process of polymerization. Now what will happen? This is called annealing. This is called annealing, this process of adding primers. Now you have to put the DNA polymerase. DNA polymerase is what? TEC polymerase, which is thermostable. And you have to put deoxynucleotides as well. Why? Because you want free nucleotides to get attached to the DNA fragment for the polymerization reaction. So you have to put polymerase enzyme as well as these free nucleotides. So what will happen? Once they are there in the solution, the polymerase enzyme will start the polymerization, and the extension can happen. The fragment will keep on extending, and whatever number of copies you want, you can get. So suppose 30 simplified, you can have up to 1 billion copies in this PCR. And as I told you, I have seen that machine. You have to just press one button and write the number of copies, and it is done. So it is so this thing interesting. You will get that instrument in biotechnology laboratories. So this is done. Now we are with multiple copies of our recombinant DNA. Now the next step is that we have to put this recombinant DNA into the competent cells. Otherwise, this DNA outside will be of no use. So we have to insert this recombinant DNA into competent cells. Now, insertion of recombinant DNA into host is done by several methods. We have learned in principles also that depending upon the host, the methods are different. Suppose transformation is done in the bacteria, then you can have the disarmed vectors like tumor-inducing plasmid, disarmed tumor-inducing plasmid vector you can use. Or you can use biolistics, that is the gene gun. You can use micro-injections. So micro-injections are used in the animal cell. The gene gun is used in the plant cell. And disarmed vectors can be used for the bacteria. Now, the self-bearing recombinant DNA. Now, your host cell has got DNA recombinant, but we don't know which cell has got the recombinant DNA and which cell has not got. That means now the cells are, whether they are transformed or they are not transformed. So, they can be transformants or non-transformants. Now, to separate these two, because we are interested only in transformants. We are interested only in the cells where the recombinant DNA has reached. So to separate these two, there are selectable markers. So the cells bearing recombinant DNA are selected because the recombinants exclusively have selectable marker present in them. So we have to choose the vector which has got the exclusive selectable marker in it. Similar to antibiotic resistance. Like we saw that in PBR322 vector, there are two selectable markers, ampicillin resistant gene and tetracycline resistant gene. So it can be antibiotic resistance. It can be any enzyme such as galactosidase when we are using chromogenic substrates to find out whether the transformants, which one are the transformants and which one are the non-transformants. Now, after that, we have got the transformants. Now, we are left with only the cells which are having the recombinant DNA. And these are the cells we are interested in. Now, we have to obtain the why we have done all this thing? Because we want that gene of interest in multiple copies. So, now we have to obtain the foreign gene product. Now, to obtain the foreign gene product, we want these host cells to multiply. So, this is the stage for which DNA, recombinant DNA was produced. The cells containing recombinant DNA will produce a novel protein product. Because why have we selected that gene? Suppose we have selected the gene for insulin. So, we want insulin. Insulin what? Insulin is a hormone, is a protein. So, whatever protein, novel protein means new protein. So, this new DNA, the recombinant DNA, is going to produce a new protein, which we are desiring. For example, insulin, for example, growth hormone, whatever we want. That is the desirable protein or desirable product for us. And that protein is called recombinant protein. So, the protein which is formed by recombinant DNA is called recombinant protein, because this recombinant DNA will, its genes will express and they will form the protein. Translation, transcription, and then replication, transcription, and then translation. And after translation, you will get the protein. So this protein is called recombinant protein. For large scale production of the desirable product. Now, this desirable product can be antibiotic, can be vaccine, can be enzymes. Like these days, the corona vaccine is in progress. So, the vaccines have been developed. So, this was the procedure. Now, they will go for human trial. Now they will go for trials. So large scale production is done by this process, by this recombinant DNA technology. So antibiotics are produced, vaccines are produced, enzymes are produced. Optimum conditions are to be provided. So for large scale production, we have to give them the optimum conditions, because when we are culturing the microorganism where our vector is present, we need that microorganism to grow very fast. So to grow, for that microorganism to grow fast, we need to provide optimum conditions. Now, what are the optimum conditions? The right kind of pH, the right kind of temperature, the right kind of pressure, everything should be right, the nutritious medium, then only we can culture the required organism. So continuous culture, used culture media is drained from one side and fresh culture media is added. So we need devices, the instruments, such instruments, devices from where we can take out the used culture and then we can put the fresh culture. So there are devices which have been used in the biotechnology laboratories for this type of culture. Now, cells are kept throughout in their log or exponential phases. They are kept in the optimal conditions so that they can be multiplying exponentially. They can be multiplying with increasing at very high speed, at high rate. And larger biomass is produced by this method, leading to higher yield. So more and more bacteria will be produced. So the larger biomass will be produced and they all are having the gene of our interest. So the gene of our interest is also multiplying. Now, this all cannot be done in a small petri dish or in a small vessel for in a small laboratory. So for all these processes, authenticated, a very sophisticated laboratory is required. So that biotechnology laboratories are there where you will find these bioreactors. So bioreactors are the large vessels. They are having the large volumes, 100 to 1000 liter, where the microorganisms can be cultured. So these are the large vessels in which large volumes of culture can be produced. And in these vessels, the optimal growth conditions for microbes are present. We will give the in bioreactor, we will keep the temperature, right pH, substrate, salts, vitamins, nutrition, whatever is required for the microbe to grow. We will keep that. So these bioreactors are of two types. Two types are given in your NCRT. The one is a stirrer type, where the air is being stirred, and one is this Sarge, the bubble is produced. So in the bubble, the surface area is increased. So the more and more air is put, the agitation of air is done so that the microbes should have the oxygen for their survival. So the stirrer is present, that helps the mixing of the reactor contents. It mixes and makes available the oxygen throughout the reactor. So this is one bioreactor. From here, this is the switch to control the pH, the acidity and the basicity of the reaction solution, that is pH. The pH can be controlled. This is the motor by which you can moving the blades. So when the blades are moving, the solution is rotating. And when the solution is rotating, the air is passed. Now from here, the sterile air is given out. From here, the steam for sterilization is given. We don't want any contamination, because if other microbes will start growing in this culture, then our culture will be contaminated and our whole purpose will be lost. So to keep it not to be contaminated with others, this is chemical engineering. We have to stop the growth of any other microbe. And then this is the second type of this thing, where the surface, this is the surge, the bubbles are rotating in this, and with the movement of this shaft, the bubbles are formed. And these bubbles are having greater surface area, so they dramatically increase the oxygen transfer area. And when they increase the transfer oxygen, so it is a conducive environment for the microbes to grow. So these are the two types of bioreactors which are given in your NCERT book. Now, after the bioreactor, bioreactor what is having? Just the structure is having the following components. Agitator system is there. Oxygen delivery system is there. Foam is what? The froth which has come out after the agitation. So foam control system is there. Temperature is there. pH control system is there. And sampling ports. What are sampling ports? After every regular time interval, you have to take out the culture and see that whether the organism which is growing is okay and whether you are getting the gene of your interest or not. Otherwise, it's of no use. So at regular intervals, you have to keep checking your sample. So that is called sampling ports. These are the outlets from which you can take out some sample and check it. So you have to take out some sample. Suppose after some time you have taken out some sample and checked. Yes, everything is okay. The organism is growing well and the gene of interest is there. We are getting our product as required. So that is called sampling ports, from where we are taking out the sample and checking it. Now last is, once everything is done, your protein is ready, everything is ready. Now what will you do it? You have to take out, you have to, from this culture, you have to synthesize your product. So first of all, you have to synthesize your product, whether it is vaccine, whether it is enzyme, whether it is alcohol, or it is any other thing, you have to synthesize. So biosynthesis of many compounds, such as enzymes, alcohols, and antibiotics takes place within the bioreactor. Bioreactor is having the culture of microorganisms where your gene of interest is producing the product which you want. Now the products so obtained are crude. Crude means raw. They are in a raw material. Raw material is there. So we have to take out this crude material which has to be separated from the other things, because there everything is there. Now we want only that protein. So all everything else is a waste for us. So once the production of protein is done, we have to separate that crude production, and that the products so obtained are crude and they require separation. First of all, you have to separate them. Then you have to purify them. You cannot just use them as it is. You have to purify them. And then finishing is done. Finishing is also done. Finishing is what? You have to pack it. Like suppose you have to send insulin tablets. So insulin tablets have to be packed in their sachets. So all these things is required finishing. So finishing is done. And this all is called downstream processes. Separating your product, commercial product which you have formed from that inside the bioreactors, separating it, purifying it, finishing it. This all comes under the downstream processing. This is called downstream processing. Now, downstream process makes a crude bioproduct marketable. Downstream process is what? It is a process which is converting the crude bioproduct, that is the raw bioproduct which we are getting from our microbes, into the marketable product. That is called downstream process. After proper separation and purification, preservatives are added, because they should not be perished, they should not be contaminated. So we have to put preservatives in it. And the finished product is made to undergo clinical trials. These days you must be hearing about clinical trials a lot in news, that vaccine is under clinical trials. So the corona vaccine is under clinical trials. So this clinical trial is also required, because it's not that immediately you will produce a tablet or you will produce a vaccine and you will start using it for humans. No, it requires clinical trials wherein voluntary human beings, they will take that, the test, they will voluntarily go for this taking this vaccine or tablet or whatever it is, and then the doctors will see that what are the side effects, what is there any side effect, is there any harm of taking that tablet, is there any harm of taking that injection, is there any harm of taking that vaccine. So all these things come in clinical trials and the quality checks. The quality of the product is checked, and then it is sent to the market. So it will need to undergo clinical trials, and quality checks are done before being sent to the market. So this is how our desirable product is formed with the help of biotechnology, by using the genetic engineering and construction of recombinant DNA with the help of recombinant DNA technology.